Reading with your kids.
Hola, ni hao, konnichiwa, assalamu alaikum, shalom, jambo, bienvenidos. Hi, my name is Jed Lee, and this is the Reading with Your Kids podcast. We are coming to you from the beautiful neighborhood of Reedville in the southwest corner of Boston, Massachusetts. We are absolutely delighted that you're part of our family. Please be sure to subscribe to the show on the iHeartRadio app, Spotify, Amazon Music, wherever you find your podcast. Our guest today is D.E. Knight. She is here to celebrate Crowns of Crosswald. Before we invite D.E. in, we want to let you know that this episode of the Reading With Your Kids podcast is brought to you by Bradley's Dragon, a fantastic middle grade read by Patrick Matthews. Set in a Florida trailer park, this middle grade fantasy adventure follows a young boy named Bradley Nash, whose world is turned upside down on his 12th birthday. It's a phenomenal read. Our panel just couldn't get enough of it. They said, seriously, I barely was able to put this down. Great characters, good plot line, really, really fun. It had me biting my nails and turning pages as fast as I could. I mean, what more can you say? It's a fantastic book, would make a great, great holiday gift for a tween or a teen that you love. It's Bradley's Dragon by Patrick Matthews. It is a Reading With Your Kids certified great read. It's available on Amazon, and also it's also available on our bookstore. Go to readingwithyourkids.com. Click on the bookstore link at the top of the page. Join us right now from Fort Lauderdale in Florida. She is the author of two great books that we're going to be talking about today, a picture book and a middle grade novel. We're also going to be talking about the unique way that she is marketing her middle grade novel. Please welcome to the show the author of Crowns of Crosswald and also the author of Opera's World, D.E. Knight. D.E., how are you?
I'm doing great. I'm excited to be here. Thanks for having me.
I'm excited to have you on, too. So much to talk about. Why don't we begin with the Crowns of Crosswald? What's this middle grade novel all about?
Sure, I would love to tell you about it. So as you said, I'm D.E. Knight, author of a middle grade fantasy series called The Crowns of Crosswald. And it's about the adventures of Ivy Lovely. She's been hidden behind an enchanted boundary for 16 years. And when she finally crosses this border, her powers suddenly awaken. And she's swept away to a school of magic where there's an evil queen after Ivy's power. It's actually a series, and there are currently three books available. There's The Crowns of Crosswald, The Girl with the Whispering Shadow, The Words of the Wandering, and I'm currently working on the fourth and final book of the series. It's a feel-good series. It's a great escape from the real world, especially now. But there's a lot of magic, a lot of adventure, friendship. You can fish for wish-granting stars in my world. You can ride on dragons. You can travel to imaginary worlds. And there's just this constant theme of challenging your fears and chasing your dreams. And I think Ivy's a really great role model for young readers. And actually, the theme of chasing your dreams inspired my very first picture book, Opera's World. So I'd love to tell you a little bit about that as well.
Yeah. Well, before we get to Opera's World, there's so much to dive into here in the Crowns of Crosswald. I know when you reached out to be on the show, you said that the series is kind of like imagine Harry Potter meets Alice in Wonderland. And that's a really cool kind of image. One of the things that I'm always fascinated about is, as you're creating, I'll be honest, there are a lot of times when I'm reading a fantasy, it is really hard for me to remember all the physics of this imaginary world and all the rules and the roles. And how do you keep that stuff straight in your own mind as you're creating this universe?
So it's actually kind of funny. I'm a very unorganized writer and I do not write in order at all. I write what I'm feeling. And so a lot of times initially when I'm writing, it doesn't make sense at first. And it just kind of, it's like a puzzle. The pieces just kind of come together. And so I try not to like think about what are the rules. I just kind of write what I love and what I'm feeling, and it feels more natural that way. But you know, everything inspires me, you know, and I just, you know, I just kind of go with what I'm feeling. So
now, do you ever come to the end of a chapter or the end of the book, and as you're going through the review process, have to go back and say, oh, wait a minute, in chapter one, you know, green turned orange, and now in chapter nine, it's turning purple. I have to go back and fix that.
Oh, yeah. I have read my book. If I can count how many times I have read my book, I probably could have read every single book in the world. I have read it so many times. And so, and everything, I'm very detail oriented. So I'm every little detail, I'm like, wait, were her eyes green or, you know, like I just, everything, it's a process. Mm-hmm. And I have my spreadsheets, of course, you know, I write down all the details. I describe my characters, my outlines. But like I said, I am not organized at all. I go with what I'm feeling and it ends up being magical.
That's really wonderful. Now, did you always dream of being an author?
No, not at all. So I'm a huge Disney fan, and it's, I'm 33 years old. I still watch Disney movies on a regular basis, listen to Disney songs. I'm a new mom, so I'm introducing my son to some of my favorites, but most of the time I'm watching them by myself. And so I tried to think of, you know, what it is about Disney that draws me to it. And I think it's the sense that, when I would watch a Disney movie or listen to a Disney song, my worries would completely disappear. And I am somebody who has struggled with social anxiety my whole life. And it was a feeling that I didn't really understand growing up. But it would definitely, you know, affect my day to day. There were things I wanted to do and I wouldn't because I was afraid, or I would worry about absolutely everything when I didn't have to. I had irrational fears. And so Disney sort of gave me this sense of comfort, and my worries would disappear. So I needed to find, something. I knew my creativity is like the one thing that gave me confidence. And I just needed to find something where I could regularly channel that creative energy in a way that made sense for me and that my anxieties would allow. So my mom, actually, she called me one day and she's like, hey, let's go see Frozen. So I was living in Ocala, Florida at the time, and we went to go see Frozen, and I was driving home feeling super inspired, started writing my first couple sentences, and writing just sort of became this creative outlet for me where no one was watching me, no one could judge me. And I could just really be me and do what I love, which is to write and create. And I wanted to create something that gave others that same self, sense of comfort that Disney gave me. And actually, it was pretty amazing. I went, you know, like I said, I have fears, and, you know, even doing this podcast today was like, you know, it's a huge accomplishment for me. I was terrified. And you know, I remember I went to my very first school visit, and I was speaking to the kids there about my anxieties and my struggles and like sort of how that inspired my writing. And I remember this one girl came up to me, she was crying to me, and she was thanking me for creating a character who was there for her when she needed her most. And it was just amazing to like, when I was talking about my anxieties, how all of the kids knew what I was feeling. They all could recognize those same feelings, and they all related to it. And I think, you know, my series, like, besides being an amazing escape into a magical world, like, I think Ivy, like I said, is a great role model. You know, she's constantly challenging her fears. And so.
Wow. Fascinating that you caught the writing bug in Ocala, Florida. I caught food poisoning there once. But
I ate at home a lot. Did some cooking. There wasn't much else to do.
Ocala is a wonderful time. It was. I'm sure. I just was there on the wrong day. I'm sure, yeah. It's a great place. I love that you're able to share about your anxiety, because I think it's especially in your school visit, because it is something that all kids deal with. Every human being deals with anxiety on one level or another. But I think it's hard for kids and adults sometimes who don't have that super anxiety that you're talking about to be able to have empathy. And I think that's something, one of the reasons we celebrate reading so much here on the show is that through reading, through getting to know characters and situations, we can develop empathy for others and allow ourselves to get in. Unlike a movie or other type of media, reading allows us to really get inside the mind of different characters and to experience what it is a person is thinking or feeling, what it is a character is thinking or feeling. So I'm happy that you have the courage to share that, and I'm really proud of you.
Thank you so much. Yeah, it was difficult at first. Like I said, I started writing because no one was watching me, and it's kind of been, I've been growing as that, you know, the book is changing me and it's helping me and, you know, overcome these fears, and readers like following along, you know, following my journey, they get to see me growing and see me come out of my shell. And I'm hoping that inspires them to come out of their shell as well. Actually, I had a girl recently, a couple of weeks ago, message me on Instagram, you know, telling me how my books gave her this sense of safety and comfort, you know, exactly what I was hoping to achieve. So it's like, it's great. And they really relate to Ivy because she experiences, you know, those same feelings. And a lot of times I get asked too, if, you know, I put myself in my characters and some of Ivy's feelings, like there's a scene where she's going to a party, and it's her first party and she's terrified of the crowd in the next room. And those are all that one page. My husband and I joke. He's like, that is you. And I'm like, yep, that is everything I'm thinking when I'm walking into a party, which is why I avoid walking into parties. So it's cool. Cause, I think they're all relatable feelings, and a lot of people, whether they know it or not, you know, feel them.
Mm-hmm. Is it therapeutic for you to kind of put these feelings down on paper?
For sure. And there was also, you know, like I was always afraid, like I said, afraid of irrational fears. I was afraid of everything, people judging me, people knowing my feelings. And it's definitely, you know, it was the scariest day publishing my book because everybody was going to judge me, the one thing that I didn't want. And so it's pretty cool.
Now, one of the things, again, before we get into opera's world, and we do definitely want to talk about that, you chose to self-publish, and again, that's a very brave decision, very difficult decision, because when you self-publish, you become the CEO of your own publishing company, and you're responsible for everything. You are marketing The Crowns of Crosswald in a really unique way. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So I, obviously, if you can get your book published, it's an amazing accomplishment. And definitely easier to get your books in the hands of readers. But given all my anxieties, I just felt that the self-publishing route was the best option for me. I was afraid of deadlines, afraid of rejection, afraid of, you know, just, the pressure. And so I thought, you know, I love being able to write at my own pace. I thought if I felt that pressure that the writer's block would strike a lot more often. and so I loved having my own timeline and write, you know, it was perfect for me. This slow and steady, basically. And so I am my own publisher. I have to handle the marketing, the bookkeeping. I, you know, when I first published the book, I had zero reviews and nobody really knew anything about me as a writer. And so I started, you know, I knew I needed reviews and I knew I needed people talking about my book. So I started brainstorming and thinking about my reader, and I discovered this whole Bookstagram community on Instagram, and they're the most wonderful people. They love talking about books. They love photographing books. And so I thought, if I can give them something visually appealing, something that they would want to take a picture of, something connected to my book, in a way that made them curious, something mysterious, that they would want to take a picture of it and want to read it and want to talk about it. And so I created this magical box. And I'm a very visual writer. So everything I love artwork. I love bringing my world to life. I included the book. I included a letter to my reader. I included a little Glenagerie bottle, which I'll talk more about when I discuss Opera's world, but it's an object for my world. And I included an illustration from a scene in the book. And so I sent those boxes to influencers, and they started taking pictures of my book and started reading it and started reviewing it. You know, I have almost, I think, 450 reviews on Amazon now, which is so cool. And I, you know, so it kind of became my thing. I started making these magical boxes for my books. They're different themes, of course. Book three, for example, circus theme. So I created a circus poster and gave them an admit one ticket and another illustration. Quills are big in my book. I have a character, they're called Scriveness, which are like the wizards of my world. And so the ring mistress has a magical quill. So I created a quill bookmark. So it made, you know, it's like giving them a little glimpse of what the book is about, because, you know, just, I know the covers are beautiful, but it's kind of hard to know what a book is really about just by looking at it. And so I just wanted to give them a little something extra. And so as my reviews began to grow and my confidence began to grow, I started traveling to book fairs across the U.S. And of course I had to work up to that because of my anxiety. But that, you know, for the past couple of years, I went to a ton of fairs. I got to meet readers, which was so awesome. And also, you know, I was across on the other side of the United States, and people were recognizing my magical box, which was so cool. They're like, "Hey, I've seen that online." So, so that was pretty cool.
Yeah. I love that you were able to go out and recognize what was going on and on Instagram and kind of create interest in your book. Without just saying, "Look at my book, look at my book, look at my book," it's, you know, you created something, a team almost of items that could really attract the interest of that community.
Yeah, for sure. It's I love it. It's so fun, and like I said, I'm a visual writer, so bringing my world to life, I figured when they'd open these boxes, they would instantly feel transported, and that was super important for me. So that's always kind of how I do things, is like, how do I want them to experience it?
Yeah. So let's get down to Opera's world. I'm looking at some illustrations of the book, and they're just fabulous.
Thank you. Yeah. So, Opera's world was actually inspired by a magical object from the Crowns of Crosswald, which is called a Glenagerie bottle. And basically your imagination can come to life within this bottle. And so they use it as a teaching tool at the Halls of Ivy, which is the magical academy in Crosswald. And the students, they get to practice their magic on a larger scale so that they don't make a mess in the classroom or their lives. And so I took that concept and of the Glenagerie bottle and explored what a child might imagine. And so Opera, she finds a Glenagerie bottle one day, and she's instantly swept into the worlds that she dreams of. And we get to see, you know, her imagination come to life. We get to see the things she dreams of becoming when she grows up. You know, a mermaid, for example, a candy maker, a veterinarian, a pirate. It's kind of like a mix of reality and fantasy. But the illustrations, as you said, they're super vibrant, super colorful. There's hidden Glenagerie bottles on every page. And so the kids love searching for those. And I work with a really, really talented artist from Norway. And so the book is just super cute. And kids love it. I gifted a copy to one of my friends. She has, a daughter, and she absolutely loves the book. It was the cutest thing. She has a little journal that she writes in, and my friend was going through it, and she just happened to find that she wrote like the first words of the first couple of pages in the notebook, and it was the cutest little discovery. She sent it to me, so I shared it with my following on Instagram, and it was just, they love it.
Yeah. You know, the thing that's interesting in speaking with you, you mentioned early on about how terrified you were to come on the Reading With Your Kids podcast. I know I am terrifying to look at. I understand that. And you talk about social anxiety and having trouble being with people, and you like to stay home. But at the same time, you have so much energy speaking here, and you're celebrating your book without any kind of nervousness in your voice, and you're talking about how you've developed this community. In reaching out to the community on Bookstagram, that Bookstagram community, you have created this beautiful community, and you're talking about, well, this person said this, and I met with this person, and I would be hard pressed to kind of prove that you have any kind of social anxiety.
It's so funny that you say that, because I was actually practicing for hours before this. My publicist was practicing with me, and I say the same things to her. I'm like, I keep blanking out. I'm so nervous. And she's like, I don't know what you're talking about. And I'm like, it's more the fear that like my mind is just going to go blank and I'm not going to know what to say. But when it comes to my world, like I love it so much and I'm so passionate about it. And the people that I speak to about it, even though it's absolutely terrifying for me, they say what you say to me. And so it's kind of like, I'm like, oh, really? I'm sweating right now. But also I have to just say, you mentioned that I created the community. I didn't create the Bookstagram community. Right. I discovered it, but mm-hmm. I just want to make that. But they're amazing people, and they're definitely a huge part of my book getting out in the world.
Right. But I understood that you didn't create that community, but you've created a community of fans, and there are a lot of authors, you know, people write to them and it's like, okay, I get that. And I look at that. Okay. But you're actually reaching out and you're creating things and you have them in mind.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, sure. And this is, I don't know. This is, I'm wondering if you're able to create this world where you appear to me and to others as being completely comfortable and confident. I wonder if there's a way that you and others who, you know, have to deal with this intense anxiety, if there's a way that you could kind of look at the greater world in the same way, so that you can go out and be excited about the world, so that you're better able to deal with the anxiety that you might be feeling.
I think the most important thing for me and other people out there is like finding something that you love to do. And I think that finding Crosswald and finding my writing has given me the confidence and something to talk about. I think the fears will always be there. Mm-hmm. And actually fear is like the main inspiration for my dark queen. But, I don't know that that will ever go away, but like finding something that you love, like I found Crosswald, is like key.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's key for a lot of people out there. And I think it's a great lesson for parents who are listening, who deal with anxiety, either, you know, they have kids who are very anxious or they are anxious themselves this might be a way for them to find some peace and happiness in their life.
For sure. Or a great fantasy book.
Or a great fantasy book. Absolutely. Absolutely. Hey, DE, we want everybody to know where they can reach out and find you. We were talking about the way you're marketing your books and how creative it is. You also have a very creative and pretty cool website.
Yeah. So my website is denight.com, and it's night like nighttime, no K. And there's a pretty cool book trailer on there. So definitely check that out. I have Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can find me on Instagram at author.denight. I'm most active on there, and I think you can see all the pictures together. I think you'll get a pretty good sense of who I am and what my world is about just by looking at it. So definitely check that out and give me a follow. I do really cool giveaways on there all the time. I do a lot of fun fantasy art. It's a pretty fun place to be. But you can find my books on Book Depository, on Amazon. You can ask for them at your local bookstore. You can also buy signed copies on my shop, which is on my website. I sell the magical boxes there. The only one I don't sell is for book one, because that is almost like a special thank you to influencers and reviewers who have helped me get my book out into the world. But there's a lot of cool Crosswald swag on there too.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, we've had a great time talking about a lot of different things, creativity, dealing with anxiety, and of course, talking about the Crowns of Crosswald and also Opera's World with the author D.E. Knight. D.E., thanks so much for being part of our show.
Thanks so much for having me.
Please be sure to join us for the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast. Our guest will be Dolev Zaharoni. He'll be here to celebrate far beyond the sun. That's the next episode of the Reading With Your Kids podcast. Hey, we gave you a sneak preview earlier. We want you to be a part of our Reading in the New Year event that is happening between Christmas and New Year's Day. It's a really, really fun virtual family book fair that you can experience at readinginthenewyear.com. It's really, really going to be fun. We have so many amazing authors taking part in this. We're going to have fantastic performances, some great do-it-together activities. You just don't want to miss it. It's a great way to say goodbye. We're done with you, 2020, and hello to all the possibilities coming to us in 2021. Check it out today. Go to readinginthenewyear.com, bookmark the page, so when everything goes live on Christmas Day, you'll be the first to experience this wonderful virtual family event, readinginthenewyear.com. Want to thank the folks who made today's show so very wonderful. Of course, want to thank our guest, D.E. Knight. Be sure to check out Crowns of Crosswald and Opera's World. Also want to thank our sponsor, Bradley's Dragon by Patrick Matthews. Check it out today. It's a fantastic middle grade read. Also want to thank my team, Alejandra Daugherty, Fatima Khan. I want to thank my beautiful wife for all the support she gives me. Most of all, we want to thank you. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. And as always, thank you so very much for taking the time to make the world a better place by reading with your kids. I'll be looking for you the next edition of the Reading With Your Kids podcast.